Hey man, how's it going?
I'm well, Dagan. How are you?
I'm very good, mate. I'm very good. I hope you're keeping safe during this quite peculiar time, and thank you for joining me.
It's a pleasure. No, I'm keeping safe. How about yourself?
I'm good, man. I'm good. Filling time up by talking to lovely people like yourselves, taking time out to talk from across the pond. It's all good, man.
Cheers.
Cool. So first off, I've been asking everyone this. How has lockdown been treating yourself? Have you been writing and recording during this time? Have you been live
Yeah.
streaming fans, or have you just been like what's quite rare for musicians and actually taking this time to chill out for once?
No, I'm not good at chilling out too much.
Good.
I've been writing and recording a lot. Yeah, just, with all the anxiety and stress and, missing people that, you care about, and there's been a lot of inspiration, a lot of stuff coming up. So that's been I guess a positive thing for it. And just playing a lot of guitar. I teach online, so I'm busier than I've ever been.
Yeah, and that's quite good. It's like
So
you using your powers for good, I guess, isn't it? In a time like this, you are writing and recording stuff, teaching people. It's great.
yeah, I mean, you gotta fill your time somehow. I don't know. I've just been more motivated and kind of mentally on track to take care of business and take care of things that I want to do, artistically and with, with work. I wasn't expecting to be this busy, so that's good.
I suppose it's quite a good thing. As musicians, we are graced with instruments and things to fill our time, and so we can utilize the situation we're in, and hopefully it'll be slightly better by the end of it, I guess.
I hope so. I hope it's positive for everyone, all of this, the outcome.
Cool, man. So what kind of
So
stuff have you been writing? Have you been doing different stuff, or is it more earthless stuff, or what have you been fiddling with?
it's been more me stuff, more different stuff. That doesn't not I mean, there's some elements that I guess you could tie to Earthless for sure. But I don't know, like the stuff that I tend to write that I, feel close to, that comes out for me is just, it's off center from Earthless for sure. It's more, vocal based,
Yeah.
songwriting, a lot of slide stuff. It's just different. I don't know, a lot of acoustic.
Yeah. You say that's kind of been inspired by the whole scenario, what's been going on, would you say?
Scenario. Yeah, you miss girlfriend. I miss my girlfriend. I miss seeing people. I miss just normal life, but it's like all that missing and distance and from her, from everybody, from everything.
Yeah.
It's gonna wear at you a little bit
Oh,
or a lot.
without a doubt, mate. But like I say, it is quite good being a musician. You can use that mental headspace for creativity, which is a lot of fun in the end.
Yeah, to me, I don't know, it feels like it's pretty brand new, like this type of this motivation and this inspiration. It hasn't been like this before for me, so I'm getting a lot more out of it than I have in the past. Any kind of troubles or whatever, this is bigger, and like the floodgates have been opened, which also for me, I have periods where I'm very, like creatively, I feel very blocked up, but right now I'm able to just be real with myself and really, create music that I'm very happy with, that I haven't been as happy with in the past, but now I'm feeling genuine, like I'm
Oh, that's very cool, man. Very good to hear. I mean, you are well known for being in the awesome three piece, which we spoke about, Earthless, which I want to talk about in a moment. But you recently joined the legendary Black Crowes for their 30th anniversary tour. 30th anniversary of Shake Your Moneymaker, going on tour with that. How did all that come about?
Well, Chris is a buddy, and he asked me to audition, and yeah, that's it. I mean, it's that simple. But yeah, we'd up in the Bay Area, we had played, shows together, and around the same friends. I played in a band called Howl and Rain, and Ethan from Howl and Rain is really, really close friends with Chris. So it just all met like that, and through Ethan, we played together. I played with Chris, and yeah, just all that kind of just happened, and he liked the way I played, and he asked me to go audition, and I got
That's amazing, mate. I mean, the reunion show last November looked pretty epic. How was it for you getting on stage and playing those tunes?
It was a lot of fun. Like, in the New York show, like, hearing the first chords to Rich playing twice as hard, like, and the crowd just electrified, and for a minute, I was in the crowd, you know? I was like, okay, I'm coming up in a second, be on point. It was like, wow, this is awesome. Yeah, it's a lot of fun. And, you know, playing with my buddies, Joel and Raj, who I've played with once in Future and in Howlin' Rain as well.
Yeah.
Once in Future band is their main band right now that you have to go listen to if you haven't. They're unbelievable.
Watching this, check them out.
Yes, Once in Future band. So they're really good buddies of mine, some of my favorite people and musicians on the planet. And so they're in the band, and the, you know, Tim LaFave, yeah, great bass player, amazing. Yeah. And Chris and Rich, there's a sound when those guys are together versus when, say, they're doing it on their own. It's together, it's special. Yeah, I think it's very special. So,
that was a good book, man. I was watching videos of it before from the reunion, from the crowd, and it looks epic. So to be on that stage must have been a pretty good feeling.
It's fun. And the band is tight. The band is really good. You know, for those shows, it was great playing with them. And the vibe and the energy is very positive and light and fun.
Yeah.
Everyone was having a good time at those two shows. So
nice, man. Well, yeah. It certainly sounded epic. I want to talk about sound now, because you've always had a pretty epic guitar tone. Did you have to change your tone much when you started playing with the Black Crowes, or did you kind of keep it the same?
Not terribly different. I mean, I was using, for those gigs, a couple Marshalls, the Blues Breakers, newer Blues Breakers. Mm-hmm. And I mean, with Earthless, my main rig is a Marshall head and an Orange cabinet. Mm-hmm. That's what I've always, that's been my go-to. So yeah, it's a little bit lower wattage, but still it's plenty loud. And in a couple of them, you know, you're going to get, you know, more of that kind of, you know, dynamic dimension sound. So the sound's there. I'm using the same pedals. I'm using more or less Pauls than I've ever used in Earthless. Like, Les Paul is more of a guitar than the Strat is. Mm-hmm. For the Black Crowes. Well, I'll use a Strat from here and there, but yeah, they, to me, it's like, yeah, they need humbuckers. They need P90s. Oh. And, you know, and trying to mix it up with Rich with every song, he's got a new guitar. So try to keep, you know, a little bit of separation tonally with him. But
nice one. Yeah. I mean, I've seen you rock on the Orange cabs for a while now. I've also saw you with a couple of Orange heads. Oh, yeah, so with the Custom Shop 50. Have you been rocking that recently?
Yeah, they hooked me up with one of those. It's fantastic. Mm-hmm. Like I said, I'm more of a Marshall person. Mm-hmm. I always have been, and in a way, I always will. But those Orange Custom Shop 50s, it did the thing that I was hoping it would do. It's the best Orange head I've ever heard.
Yeah, there's something really special about Orange cabs as well. You can compare a lot of other cabs, and they all kind of sound the same, like Marshalls and Mesas and stuff. But Orange cabs have their, because they're so thick and epic, they've got their own unique sound, haven't they?
Oh, big time. I mean, when I was first turned on to Orange, it was, I worked at a guitar shop in San Diego, Encinitas, California, Moonlight Music, and Russell there, he had in his garage, I was helping him clean out his garage, he had a couple of in-the-boxes Orange 412 cabs, and I was 17 or 18 at the time, and I was like, I need a cabinet. Oh, I got the perfect cab for you. And so I went over to the house, and it's like, it's beautiful, it's bright orange. I had never even seen this stuff yet. I'm still green as a musician and not very, I don't know all the gear.
Yeah,
whatever.
You know what sounds so good.
Yeah, so I mean, he took it out of the box, we played it, it sounded great. And I noticed right away, like, how thick the walls were of the cab. Mm. And I was like, okay, this is a really heavy duty cab. And then, you know, I played it against like 70s Marshalls cabs, 80s Marshalls cabs. I A-beat it against all this stuff, like 70s high watt cabinets. And I, you know, nothing sounded as good. Where I was using the same speakers too, like, and that one I think had 75s in it.
Yeah.
The Orange I still have 75s, I'm pretty sure. So it wasn't the exact same speaker, but just you could hear the bottom and the deepness and the fullness of the orange compared to every other cab. And I attribute that to, you know, those walls, you know, it's how they build them, the structure of them.
Oh yeah, they don't budge.
Yeah, so I was like, man, you got me. Like, I've been sold ever since. And I just, also when they sent me that custom shop 50, they sent that newer 212, the upright one, the vertical one with the backs. Wow, that's an amazing cabinet. That's beautiful.
It pushes a lot of air for being very thin and tall, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's fantastic. I want a lot of them, or as many as I can, or whatever. I don't know, whatever. Yeah, that's good.
So even though you're saying you're not much of a like intense gearhead, I've got to talk about that strat you use, because that's pretty damn epic. Can you talk the guys through what some specs on your strat, if you know how, if you have the specs?
Yeah, no, I'm a gearhead. It's just I'm not like some people I know, but no strat, no one knows what it is. There's not a serial number on the thing to tell you what it is. I thought it was maybe the first era of those 80s custom shop, or the 80s vintage reissues, like the 50s, like early or mid 80s, whenever they did that.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. I just got it off my dad's, my buddy's dad, for like $300. So
nice.
The neck was perfect, you know, a medium V profile. It was all about that neck. I'd never played a neck like that up to that point. So I hounded my buddy forever for that guitar, and he caved in. Because he's a good friend. So, and so I've gone through multiple pickups on that thing. Right now I'm using Brearley pickups. He's a Mick Brearley builds in Australia, I think Adelaide or Canberra, I can't remember, but somewhere in Australia. I love his pickups. I've got what is that stuff? Callahan Bridge set up. It's a full tremolo system. Works fantastic. Finally have, after all these years, figured out how to use the Wang bar intensely and have it stay in tune.
Yeah, there's a knack to it.
Yeah, so with that guitar, it's finally dialed. I mean, that's pretty simple. I like kind of the old, you know, old style, nothing, no new bells or whistles on it. It came with lace sensors and a humbucker in it, and I'm like, no. But that was my friend's dad.
Yeah,
made his own graphite nut, graphite saddles, and was like, nah.
Cool. Well, now it's very much your guitar, because you can tell by looking at it, it's been very much part of you now.
It is my guitar all the way. It is how I would like my guitars to feel and sound, and, you know, strat wise at least.
What kind of Les Pauls are you keen on then for the crows?
I got a couple of the newer custom shop models. I got a 59, was that the R9?
Yeah, man.
Humbuckers, and it's beautiful. Like, the weight is fantastic. The neck size is perfect. It's, you know, little, not quite baseball batty, like a 58, which I'm more keen on, but it's still, like, it's fantastic. It's fat enough for me. I like big necks. And then they got me equipped with a 56 gold top with P90s. Excellent. And that's like one of my all time like dream guitars. I would have I dream about that guitar when I was a kid. Nice. Like a gold top with P90s in it. I got a custom shop and it's fantastic. The pickups are fantastic.
They're nice.
Just play. Yeah, no, I have a lot of fun playing them.
So with you dreaming about gold tops when you were a kid and stuff, what kind of got you into guitar playing? Was it a Les Paul guy or any specific band or guitar player?
No, it's my dad. Like, my dad, Stephen, he's a bass player. And he'd take me to band practice when I was 1, 2, 3. So, I mean, I just grew up around it. And I just, so iconically, that 70s Fender headstock, like with the spaghetti.
Big chunky.
The big chunk, whatever they call that, and the large headstock. Like, early on, I just have vivid memories of looking at that headstock of his jazz bass and his guitar players, Strat, and also a Tele. Just those iconic, those shapes. So it's ingrained really early, but now my dad, you know, brought me up on Blue Cheer, Black Sabbath, Weather Report, Joni Mitchell. all sorts of stuff. Like mom and dad were awesome with that. So, yeah, it all started there, and you know, him and I play together, and we're actually working on some recording projects of actually songs that he wrote. I think before I was born, I remember him playing those at band practice. So we're just starting to do some recording stuff together right now. So
that's really cool, man.
Oh, it's awesome. Yeah.
Good father son bonding.
Oh yeah. Yeah. That's one thing we've always had is music. It's definitely been the main thing. He's the main catalyst, inspiration for picking up an instrument. And, yeah.
Nice, man. Well, it sounds like you've got a lot of projects going on at the minute. Any kind of news on any Earthless stuff coming out?
No, not right now. We, we're trying to work on a new record, but at the same time, we're unable to rehearse at the moment. So I'm back down in San Diego. So hopefully we can get together soon and start writing, you know, before any of the Crow stuff picks up, which no one, of course, knows when anything's going to pick up. But yeah,
he was supposed to be touring in like a worldwide tour, wasn't it? Starting in June-ish time.
Yeah.
Oh man.
And Earthless had like a week's worth of gigs at the end of this month, and got it. You know, as everyone's story is going right now.
But, that was fun. Well, I've got a couple of fan questions from some guys. One of them was, what got you into playing guitar? The other was, have you got any specific guitars you use for the studio than what you use live? Have you got any kind of special studio guitars, or is it kind of the same guitar throughout?
No, I mean, I do have a guitar that records, I think, better than anything I have. It's my favorite guitar to record with. My uncle built it. I call it the Uncle Jerry.
Nice.
And it's got Brearley P90s. He used he had this piece of cherry wood hanging around forever. He's a woodworker, amazing builder, amazing anything he gets his hands on. He's brilliant at it. And he never built a guitar before, and he wanted to build me a guitar. So he built it out of this cherry wood he had lying around for like 30 years. I got the perfect piece. And it's heavy, but it's not overly heavy. And I played it live a bunch. But recording, it's fantastic, you know, with the Brearleys and combination of wood, and he built it. That's
my favorite. Is it like single cut shape or Strat shape, or I don't know what to do with it?
He's into like 50s hot rods. Like he's like restoring an old Lotus, and there's this other thing that looks weird. You know how they have the really bubble looking fenders and front ends? It's like a Les Paul met with that kind of mindset. It's a weird shape. As that was his first guitar, I let him have total carte blanche. Because you do what you want, I'm going to play it. And, people are like, what the hell is that? All the time. Because it's a weird looking guitar, but it's beautiful. I don't know. It plays fantastic. And from, you know, where it comes from, it's very, a very important guitar. And it just happens to record fantastic.
Yeah, that's like a little bonus at the end, isn't it? Cracking.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's great. Very usable.
Nice, man. So you got some badass pedals as well. Have you got a couple of your favorite pedals? Like your always go-to pedals, whether it be an overdrive or a cool ethereal soundscape delay, or what do you like?
Oh, man. Well, in like the game world, I'm a treble booster guy. I love like OC44 transistor treble boosters. Yes.
Hell yeah.
I collect those. So I'm a little bit of a gearhead. I mean, I've got like maybe 150 pedals or something. So
nice. That ticks the box for gearhead then.
Yeah. I'm a nerd. I've got Echoplexes, like an EP3 or EP2 is my favorite of all time delays. I really want to get my hands on an Echolet. That's one of the goals. Like the dude from Dungan has, because his sounds fantastic. Fuzzwah, like I have a Fox Fuzzwah, like the 70s one. That's just aggressive and ridiculous and spitty, and I use that for a lot of recording. I don't really have it live, but I've used it a ton for recording. It's a go-to pedal.
You don't take Echoplexes out with you, do you? Or
I do all the time, but now it's just more difficult because I like to carry my guitars on the plane, and sometimes my pedals It's just too much stuff. And then like once it breaks, that's really not optimistic. Like if it breaks on tour, it's like you're lugging this Echoplex around and
it's just for a reason. They're not the most reliable delays in the world.
No, you know, one's pretty good, but you know.
Yeah, I mean, the way technology works now, there is some amazing modeler pedals which sound almost identical to the crowd as well. They won't be able to tell the difference between an EP1 or a one player.
Sure, yeah. I mean, like a pedal that I've used in replacement of the Echoplex is a SIB Electronics. What is that called? It's the delay drive. I'm just blanking all of a sudden, but it's a 12AX7 powered tube delay. It's a big old red honking thing. Nice. I guess Josh also uses the same one. Echo Drive. Yeah, they're fantastic. Very warm, and they're designed to, you know, get along the lines of a EP3 and all that. So
I'll check them out, definitely.
Yeah, very cool. But I like the Hot Cake for overdrive. Mm-hmm. That's a great one. Tim Guitars. I have I got like these guys right here. Like this Tim Guitars in Australia. He made me a triangle Big Muff with a color sound tone boost in it. This is great. Then also there's that SIB company. Fantastic fuzz bass, as well as like an Octavia kind of sound in there. I love these guys. So I don't know. I'm more of a treble booster person than a fuzz, but I'm learning to get along with them a little bit more.
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing wrong with having both.
No, you'll need it somehow. Even though stuff sits most of the time, like, you know, I use it. And also, like, the Crybaby Mini Wahs are fantastic.
Yeah.
Like, I've been using the crap out of those, and they sound good to me, and they take up less real estate on your board. And yeah, there's just so much stuff. I got it. Make Sounds Loudly out of Oregon is a great pedal builder. There's so much. Yeah,
that's badass. Well, everyone watching this right now and watching in the future, check out the pedal companies that Zaya just spoke about, because if you can get them to sound awesome.
Yeah, they do. They sound fantastic.
Nice one, dude. And finally, being a renowned musician as yourself, have you got any tips for any musicians out there pulling their hair out during this quarantine time?
Try to harness that hair pulling tendency into creating something beautiful or aggressive, whatever you can do to just kind of heal yourself through it all. It's therapeutic. Music's therapeutic, as we all know. So I just try to harness it and be creative and stay positive if you can. And I know we'll all get through it, but yeah, just use your time wisely. Don't go backwards and be like, oh, I had all this time and I just didn't do it, you know? So that kind of stuff.
Very cool, man. Well, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us today. I'll see you on the road soon, whether it be with Earthless or the Black Crows. And stay safe, man.
I hope so, Dagan. Cheers, man.